In 1973, English art rockers Roxy Music were on a roll, releasing their third album in the span of 20 months with the November release, Stranded, and from that album, the track Amazona. Already, we've got this really like funky type rhythmic structure and guitar figure, and those like sweeping like earth spacey kind of synthesizer sounds, which show that the changeover in lineup has not really affected the band stylistically all that much. They've still got the this like Eddie Jobson doing a good job, kind of like. Maintaining that avant-garde element that had been with the band from day one, but he also, of course, adds a whole lot more, like because of his classicism, which would be evident in various other tracks on the album. And Bryan Ferry having that kind of decadent croon that he was, you know, personified, that was very unique for its time, but would be very influential in the years that would follow. To El Dorado, sure is a mighty long way. Section just has this avalanche-like quality of just all these sonic waves and sound, and like Paul Thompson just kind of like struggling to keep himself from losing balance in it. Let's catch up with the lyrics here. Amazona is a zone where there is no doubt, no more fallout. Why don't you step through the mirror and see? I'm thinking, offhand, I'm just thinking that the title is a play on the Amazon, but let's see if the lyrics support that. From Arizona to El Dorado. Now, all of a sudden, I'm thinking that it may be like a portmanteau involving the state of Arizona. Sure is a mighty long way. Hey, little girl, is something wrong? I know it's hard for you to get along. The bell tower rings, it tolls a hollow sound. But your castles in Spain, we're darting around the world here, still may be realized, and longings more profound. You see, every cloud has a silver lining, and sometimes paradise around your corner lies. In Amazona, everything is nice. Little one, come take my hand. I'll try to help you there. I'll take you there. Amazona's getting closer. Soon you'll see, journey's over. We're almost there. Huh. Co-written between Bryan Ferry and Phil Manzanera. I'm gonna have to give these lyrics a bit of thought. Let's just get back to the track. Eddie Jobson's kind of distorted synth tones are colliding with the effects that Phil Manzanera is employing. I'm wondering if Phil Manzanera is playing his guitar through pedals that are linked with Jobson's arsenal, because I've read that that Manzanera and Eno employed something like that. Or would play his guitar through. Someone comment if you know that technological underpinnings of this whole sound shaping we've got here. We've really gone into like a spacey psych funk section here. Here at Manzanera's guitar tone, the way it just like sears and cuts that trebly sound and the spacey other, you know, that are totally forgotten about this section. Now it's like they're going into a wind tunnel or something. They must really be in the thick of it somewhere, wherever the narrator and the subject of the song have wound, you know, have whatever situation they're in. I'm almost picturing something kind of like a... I'm picturing an adventure. Like, if my original assumptions about the title and the subject of the song held true, I would imagine that they were in the thick of the Brazilian rainforests or something. Amazona, getting closer. Oh, as indicated in that very last line, they were on some kind of journey, some pursuit of some kind. Let's see if I really like how on this particular track the band is finding like a new bridge between the rhythmic music that was going on in the United States at the time. Urban, rhythmic, soul funk, and the kind of the space rock that was going on in the United Kingdom. So kind of basically a marriage of space rock and funk, and yet also bringing in these like fractious elements, discorded sounds, and that weren't really part of either style up at that point. Maybe somewhat borrowed from like the more free form aspects of like psychedelic jazz rock. So they were utilizing these very different musical styles that no one had really found any common ground between yet. Although in the years ahead, you would end up with more performers who had been listening to bits of both or all, you know, of these, you know, eventually it would take shape, but no one had thought of that as early as 1973. Let's see if someone has cracked the meaning on this one. And let's see, who played bass on this album? John Gustafson. Yeah, they changed bassist about every album. Let's see, Bryan Ferry had some, let's see, does this, I'll see, I'll try, hopefully each of the, hopefully the comments I read will actually be about the song without going off topic. This song seems to be a play on words Amazon and Arizona. However, it's a state of mind where self-confidence reigns over vanity. And then the commenter says, I think, songmeanings.com is where I'm reading here. Amazona, a contact high razor sharp, song lines glittering in a mirror, a state of fluid associations roaming the arid zones of the western U.S. Ubermensch meets supermodel in absolute freedom, the golden one ever sought, never found, indigenous daughter of the new world, savage grace complements old world charm. I guess these are just all random impressions of what the song could mean. Zarathustra's bride waiting in a Tucson honky-tonk, road trip in a Cadillac, on heaven's golden highways. Let's see. A distorted guitar in the song pushes the... I guess no one really knows what this song means. Yeah. Let's see, song facts. The song was co-written by, Phil Manzanera said years later, Bryan Eno had just left the band and the opportunity arose for me to contribute some music for the first time. Huh? I didn't know, heck, I guess I'd have to check the credits. I didn't know that Phil Manzanera didn't contribute song ideas to the first two albums. It turned out to be my first recorded track on an album, and I was very proud of it. When I finished recording the guitar part, everyone shared the control. Huh? Doesn't even sound like he's... I'm wondering if... That's... I don't even know how relevant that is. It was that was from a 2009 interview. I'm often not really interested in what surviving musicians from the 1970s really have to say in interviews about their works from the 70s all these years later, because I sometimes wonder how accurate their memories would be at this point. And I also sometimes wonder if musicians are getting kind of shoehorned into certain narratives through constant repetition by slanted journalists who have like a narrative bias or agenda. That's why I generally am mostly interested in comments that are made at the time, like right after an album comes out, rather than... 4 decades later. It's kind of why I don't read those music online publications or anything that basically market themselves as like that are just like interview after interview of surviving 70s musicians. Yeah. Anyway, that was Amazona off Stranded by Roxy Music, their 1973 third album. Let's hear another track, Sunset. Very crisp, kind of echoey, simple piano lines unaccompanied, the likes of which Ultravox would be appropriating, particularly during the Fox era, but like on My Sex, Just for a Moment, and that section between between Fear in the Western World and While I'm Still Alive. Yeah. And something that Gary Newman would also use quite a lot, like on Please Push No More. Yeah. Japan also did arrangements like this. Like, there's that one song on Quiet Life, like, third song on side one. Croon, that kind of slightly mournful tone.
Still the noise company until morning when larks will sing. Horizons upon.
That droning sound that's kind of like filling out the sonic space. I mean, we mostly got like unaccompanied, like rhythmless piano and vocals, but there's that, it almost kind of sounds like a digeridoo.
For sun's swim from mingles must sleep. Seems like bees from.
It's going like.
My dreams cover cutting room floor.
I wonder who's causing that sound. Is it Eddie Jobson? Love that arrangement with the kind of soft bass and the high kind of tinkly piano over it. That arrangement, even more so now, this is starting to remind me of those examples that I was mentioning a couple of minutes ago from like the later 70s, early 80s, New Romantic era.
Mm-hmm.
double-tracked piano here. It seems like there's more than two hands playing.
Warm heart, we spin slowly from view.
There were definitely two pianos because I was hearing like what sounded like the high end, then I was hearing like lower end, and then I was also hearing like some like more chord based. I'm wondering if Bryan Ferry was playing along. Yeah, Bryan Ferry plays piano on the album, as does so both Ferry and Eddie Jobson are playing piano on this.
Why are you sad? Do you disapprove? How we've wasted our time. Sunset, end of my day.
Actually, I'm wondering if that droning sound might be courtesy of Andy Mackay, like filtering one of his woodwinds through an effects pedal or something to make it kind of low and almost unrecognizable and just drony and sustained.
My dear Clyde, postscript, you trace colors the sky. Red letter light fades is filed away.
Let's catch up with the lyrics. Oh, look at the sun, it's all aglow. Slow burning star, sinking low. Heaven knows where you go. Out of sight, out of mind's eye, no. Ah, such a shame, you must leave. All day long you were a friend to me. Still the moon's company. Huh. Let's see. Is he talking about a person, or is he just talking about it like a force of nature that embodies meaning to him? Let's see. Until morning, when larks will sing, horizon's appointment you'll keep. I kind of sense that he's giving nature, Mother Nature, sentience here and addressing it like a subject. For sun-swept flamingos must sleep, scenes like these from my dreams, cover cutting room floors all over. Warm heart, we spin slowly from view. Why are you sad? Do you disapprove? How we've wasted our time, sunset, end of my day, my decline. Postscript, you trace colors, you trace colors the sky, red letter light fades, I think that prior line may have had a typo, is filed away, sunburst fingers you raise, one last sigh of farewell. This is about, the sunset is being addressed, this isn't about a person, this is about sunset being addressed as though it's sentient. The way that people oftentimes, do with trees, they do with all kinds of Mother Nature. They do it with mountains. Like, mountains, aren't mountains referred to by feminine pronouns at times? I know that ships are. In fact, I think even the, isn't the sun referred to, like, by a masculine or feminine pronoun at times? Let's see, comment. I read someplace, can't remember where, that the song represents Bryan Ferry's acknowledgement that the glam rock era was ending. I doubt it. Yeah, that was some comment around song. Nah. I don't think anyone in 1973 was really self-conscious. Oh, I'm part of this movement called glam rock. Because movements tend to only get recognized retroactively. That's not to say that like a certain amount of performers that were wearing those satin outfits knew that there was like a trend going on of satin outfits. And, but when you just glam rock was such an incoherent musical aesthetic anyway. I mean, you have Cockney Rebel, Roxy Music, David Bowie, T-Rex, Slade. None of these bands sounded anything alike. Mott the Hoople. None of them. I mean, that, especially you could say you could. Okay, here's all I'll say. You could say that you had like this kind of bubblegummy hard rock that could be classified as like glitter pop per se, and then like Slade, T-Rex, Gary Glitter. And then you had bands that were doing very different music that was much more maximalistic, poetic, that used a lot more layers, experimentation, you know, classicized maximalism colliding with elements of atonal free form playing at times, like Roxy Music. Who were really the only, well, they were really the only one doing that. And then Bowie kind of got into that territory. And then you had like, let's just say you had a bunch of art rock bands that were exploring different facets of maximalism, be it the kind of fractious, like Euro chic, lounge rock of so much ground covered by Roxy Music that you can't even, that five descriptors aren't even going to do them justice. Never at all sounding anything like the glitter pop bands, not resembling them in terms of vocals, not resembling them in terms of song structure, you know, not. And then you had like Bowie kind of moving kind of into that territory on the Aladdin Sane album. And then you had Cockney Rebel, who were going at maximalistic art rock from a totally different angle, combining music hall with orchestral lavishness, combining more of like a Kinks influence. Like the Kinks meets Andrew Powell or something, not really any continental influence. Like Ferry was really into like the chanson, the German cabaret of the Weimar period, although all those influences creep in. So there's really just no cohesiveness to the, and then there's Queen, a whole nother story altogether, basically a hard rock metal band that incorporated elements of opera and orchestral lavishness and even music hall on occasion. None of these. And so I reject the whole concept of glam rock. It's too diffuse. Like with punk, at least you could say that there was a definite aesthetic, you know. Buzzsaw, like trebly guitar, you know, wall of sound over a really, you know, with tout adenoidal vocals and a brisk four wallops per bar played as briskly as possible within the context of a cohesive melodic song. Anyway, getting a little bit carried away here. Let's finish this track.
Sunburst fingers you raise, one last sigh of farewell. Thank you.
some sounds that I think are manipulated from Annie Mackay's woodwinds. I also suspect that some of that Jobson string instruments could be, but he only plays violin. I don't know of him playing. I would think like if Jobson was known to play like larger string instruments like a bass, but no. That was Roxy Music with the track Sunset from the 1973 release Stranded. And on this album, it's the classic core of the band, Bryan Ferry on vocals, Phil Manzanera on guitar, Andy Mackay on woodwinds, with Paul Thompson on drums. They're the guy behind the kit for their first coming anyway, 72 to 75. And then newcomer Eddie Jobson, fresh off his stint with Curved Air, who takes the place of the departed Brian Eno, and adding a bit more of a classicized element, because Eddie Jobson wasn't just a keyboardist like Eno, he was also played violin. And the bassist for this album, John Gustafson, I don't know, did he play on the prior album? Roxy Music never had a permanent steady bassist. It's surprising to find even two albums where they retain the same bassist. I think on the next album that it was John Wetton. You know, there were like, in fact, they changed bassists so often that the two different versions, the UK and US versions of their first album, picture a different bassist. I think like one played on the album, the other played on the Virginia Plains single, which wasn't included on that on UK copies of that first album anyway. Yeah. Roxy Music, a very, let's just say a band that had ideas that hadn't occurred to anyone else at the time of their arrival. There you had like the post-psych maximalism spawned by Sgt. Pepper, and you know, in 1971, 1972, the explorations of people had been exploring, you know, the symphonic ideas born from the grooves of A Day in the Life, and taking that to its like maximalistic, grandiose, well, up higher and higher. And basically the emphasis at the time was a mixture of contemporary post-psych whimsy mixed with old world charm. It's like that was the thought of as like the perfect balance. It's like offsetting all of the then current like Technicolor whimsy with like a pre-20th century charm, be it classical era, the Baroque or Renaissance time periods that the symphonic bands were exploring, or the 19th century rustic old Western vibes that like American rustic rockers, country rock bands were exploring to offset the uncertainty of an increasingly technological future. And then no one was really into like Weimar Germany, like interwar Europe, 1920s France, the City of Lights, film noir of the 1940s. Those influences weren't being brought into the lexicon of rock, and I guess primarily it was Bryan Ferry had this idea of forming a rock band that conjured those various aesthetics from like the 1920s, like starting from like the Bauhaus, you know, and you know, through Weimar Germany, you know, the City of Lights, Paris in the 1920s, and up through like film noir, classic Hollywood, and wedding that to a musical backdrop that incorporated those European elements and infused them with elements of like a kind of like fractious technological future that embraced freeform playing at times, freeform soloing anyway, with kind of like an almost cybernetic vision of the future. It was like, so it was the perfect marriage between post Great War Western art and culture with perhaps kind of like a 1920s vision of the future, like, and those were combinations that would be more, that would be explored more in depth during the New Romantic era. And starting with like bands like Ultravox, Gary Numan, and such. No one else in the early 70s had thought of it. It was like, so basically that's basically the difference between the early 70s and the early 80s. The early 70s was all about marrying the technicolor post-psych whimsy of the present with the more comforting classicism or rusticism of like the 19th century on back, whereas the early 80s, as with Roxy Music as the forerunner in all this, was about marrying post-Great War European avant-garde art and urban culture with kind of this this metropolis or things to come like view of the future, like this cybernetic future and industrialized future, and two very you could say that the early 80s wed the past with the future, and the early 70s it was more about the present with the past and trying not to think so much about the future. Anyway, that could be a subject for a whole nother video in and of itself. For more rubies and sapphires from the catalog of Roxy Music, see the directory of albums by English R artists, linked in the description below. For Red Hot Tracks and Tasty Purples from this album, the two before it, and the two after it, as well as from their second coming, between 1979 and 1982. And then from there you can go to the other letters in the directory to see the solo catalogs of Ferry, you know, Phil Manzanera and such. Like and subscribe, follow me on social media, and leave a comment if there are any observations you have about the two tracks that we just heard, the lyrics, the layers, the meaning, the particularly of Amazona. What did that song mean? What are your interpretations? Yeah, which solo stood out to you? Which effects do you think were employed to get certain sounds, make them possible by like Manzanera, Jobson, etc.? And until next time, this is Zaragon, the world's most ear-troubled trimaximalist, signing off.